Good morning. I got a couple announcements for you. First of all, just another reminder about that we're going to be starting our Psalms Bible study. It's going to be on the Zoom meeting platform. It's going to start February 2nd, but apparently a bunch of us other churches want to do Psalms as well because our books got back ordered, and apparently their printer, the company's printer, went out of business in December because of COVID. So they had to find another printer and all this stuff. Anyways, long story short, I'm supposed to have those books by tomorrow. Hopefully that'll happen. And if it does, then we'll still keep that February start date and have 10:30 and 7 o'clock times. If you never worked with Zoom before, all you really need is a telephone. That's at the simplest way. Even your home phone can work, in which you dial into a number and basically you can listen and talk that way. But the best way is either through a computer or through your iPad or even your iPhone or some kind of smartphone, and then you could see and everybody else. But that's going to be starting on February 2nd. If you have any questions about that, and hopefully I'll have books for you this coming Sunday. The other thing I want to let you know about is that this past week, your year-end giving statements were sent out, so you could use those for your taxes if you want to. And so if you didn't receive it by now, we did already, but if you haven't received it by now, and maybe wait a couple more days, call the church office. We'll make a duplicate copy, and you can either pick it up or we'll mail it to you again. But those are available and have been sent out. I know people use those for their taxes, and it's something that if you didn't get and you want, just let our office know, okay? I think that's it. So we're going to listen and silently sing along with our opening music.
News of great joy for every woman, every man. This will be a sign to you, a baby born in Bethlehem. Come and worship, do not be afraid. Company of angels, glory in the highest. On the earth, the peace among
Dan. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Almighty God, by grace alone you call us and accept us in your service. So strengthen us by your Holy Spirit and make us worthy of your call. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Have a seat. We have our children's moment.
Hi, kids. Pastor Brett here. Have you ever tried to push open a door and then you discovered that you needed to pull it open instead? Doing something like that can make us feel silly, doesn't it? What would be even sillier is that if, even after you found out that you needed to pull the door, you continued to push on that door. That would really be silly. You know, sometimes we make mistakes and we're headed for trouble. But did you know that God is always trying to help us go the right way? Yeah, mistakes happen. But when they happen, we need to gladly try to do something different when we discover that we're going the wrong way. And Jesus is there to help us. Jesus forgives us, and he helps us turn in the right direction. And he's always walking with us. That's good news. I'll talk to you next time.
The book of Jonah is a comedy starring a reluctant prophet who is given a one-sentence message. Nineveh will be destroyed in 40 days. Much to Jonah's dismay, the people of Nineveh repent. The point of the story is to get the reader to wrestle with the question, on whom should God have mercy? A reading from Jonah chapter 3. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk, and he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. And the people of Nineveh believed God, and they proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. The word of the Lord. Paul does not disapprove of marriage or other human social institutions. He does, however, want Christians to live in the present in fervent anticipation of God's future, which even now has dawned through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. A reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 7. Brothers and sisters, the appointed time has grown short. From now on, let even those who have wives be as though they had none, and those who mourn as though they were not mourning, and those who rejoice as though they were not rejoicing, and those who buy as though they had no possessions, and those who deal with the world as though they had no dealings with it. For the present form of this world is passing away. The word of the Lord.
Gospel reading today. Before Jesus calls his first disciples, he proclaims a message that becomes known as the gospel, or the good news from God. God is ready to rule our lives, and those who realize this will respond with repentance and faith. The Holy Gospel according to Mark, the first chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Now after John the Baptist was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat mending the nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of every heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. Well, January is a beginning month, isn't it? It's the beginning of the new year, so isn't it timely that our gospel reading today from Mark is describing an important beginning of a ministry, probably the most important in history, that is the ministry of Jesus. And we discover in what Mark reports not only a little bit about the worldly wisdom of Jesus, but also about what he understood his purpose to be on earth here, and the point of his ministry, and even something about his leadership qualities. Jesus is clearly, he clearly had what each of us needs in our life. That is a clear vision of why we're here and decisiveness to make a start at fulfilling our calling, even if we can't foresee where it's going to lead us. So let's first notice the practical wisdom of Jesus. Okay, this reading occurs about after the 40 days that he spent in the wilderness deflecting various temptations from the devil. And he just learned that his cousin, John the Baptist, had been arrested. So does Jesus then hang out around whatever passed for a Starbucks back then and just idly chat with people about what happened to John? Did you hear what happened to John? No, he doesn't do that. Instead, Jesus gets the heck out of Dodge, or at least out of Nazareth, and goes north to a town called Capernaum. It was a small fishing town on the northwest shore of the Sea of Galilee. Now, Jesus knows that if John was arrested for proclaiming a message of repentance and the inbreaking reign of God, well, he's in danger too then, because he planned to echo John's message even in stronger terms. So Jesus decided that if he were to have a ministry at all, well, he best not set himself up for a quick arrest. Now, we do know that he does get arrested, of course, sometime later, 3 years later. For now, Jesus obviously hopes to launch his startup ministry in a friendlier territory. So he heads to Capernaum, which would become an important center for the Galilean followers of Jesus. It's basically his headquarters. And once he's settled in Capernaum, or at least as settled as the Son of Man who has no place to lay his head can get, Jesus knows that this new ministry of his needs some staff and needs some followers, some disciples. So it's kind of a mystery, though, how Jesus knew to pick the 12 disciples he did. He doesn't appear to have had a long interview process or any sort of human resources department. And we know he couldn't post a job for a disciple on the internet, right? No, instead he starts wandering around Capernaum and the broader Sea of Galilee area proclaiming, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." And then hoping that this surprising announcement will gain him both attention and followers. Now, scholars say that the term that gets translated into English as kingdom usually means reign or rule or even authority. And what John the Baptist and Jesus proclaimed was that this reign of God, which was long promised and hoped for, was beginning. It was breaking in. So Jesus wanted people to know that they could experience God's reign this very day, a reign of mercy, love, justice, love, and compassion. Did I mention love? So that's the message Jesus announced, to launch the work God gave him to do on this earth. And it's a message to which Jesus' earliest followers, they responded when he said to them, "Follow me." Now, Mark reports that as Jesus was walking along the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, Peter, and Andrew, and they were fishing. He asked them to come with him and fish for people, which of course means to help share the gospel message, the good news about God's reign, so that people will want to repent and reboot their lives. Clearly, Jesus was stunningly and quickly persuasive with them, for Mark says that Peter and Andrew immediately left their nets and followed him. And the same goes for the sons of thunder, James and John. It turns out to be a great career move for all of them. And what I want you to know is that Jesus remains equally persuasive today, but you must take time to hear him call you. You see, the more you read about him, the more you encounter his words, the more you listen to the testimony of others who have chosen to follow Jesus, the more you're open to the Holy Spirit regenerating your heart and mind and soul, the more eager you'll be to respond to Jesus' enticing call to exit darkness in which you are sitting and join him in the great light and that he brings and that he is. This living, risen Christ continues today, even today, to say to you and to me, follow me. And it's each morning that we get to renew our decision to do exactly that. As morning breaks, we get to decide that this is the day that the Lord has made, so we will not just rejoice and be glad in it, but we can also share with others about the joy in living in God's kingdom today that it brings us. Now the question then begs, has God's kingdom or reign, which Jesus talked about 2,000 years ago that was near, has it come to full flower today? Well, if you look around, obviously the answer is no. Not with wars and rumors of wars, not with injustice, racism, crime, hard-heartedness, and addiction and selfishness seemingly everywhere we look. But here's the thing. It's our job to demonstrate in small ways what the kingdom will look like when it's fully consummated. So we work today for justice because God's fully realized reign would be marked always and everywhere with justice. We work to house the homeless and feed the hungry in God's fully arrived kingdom, those problems will be no more. We teach the illiterate. We visit prisoners. We care for the lonely. Now, in this imperfect world, to demonstrate what life will be like when everyone is literate, when no one is an inmate, and when not a single person on the planet is lonely in the full-come kingdom of God. But first, we must respond to Jesus when he says, as he did to Peter and Andrew, follow me. And once we have chosen to become Christ's disciple, then it's important that we recommit ourselves to this demanding call each day. Because if we don't, we're likely like sheep to wander away from the shepherd. Happens to me pretty regularly. When I start focusing on too much in this world, and I forget the call that Jesus keeps making to me every day, follow me. And it happens to all of us. That's why it's a daily renewal. That's why spiritual disciplines are so important. Disciplines like prayer and meditation and even silence or Bible study or worship. These and similar practices, they move us again and again to renew our decision to live as Christ followers, as people who this very day can experience something of what the reign of God will be like when, in God's good time, it comes in full force. Our task, beloved people of God, is to say yes to the call of Christ to follow him, to share God's redeeming light in those places in the world that are stumbling around in darkness, that is, where sin and greed and apathy have made their homes. And by doing that, we ourselves get transformed so that we may help others be transformed into a world, a more loving place, a more generous place, a more welcoming and peaceful place. It's not perfect, but it's a place where when people hear Jesus ask them to follow him and his way, they immediately say yes and begin to love others, whoever they are, whatever, wherever they are, and whenever they are. And that is whenever they need that kind of love. And of course, it's every day. It's something that's imperfect on this side of heaven, but something that we're still called to do and have a vision of. So I pray that the yes that you made, may have said to Jesus many years ago, is still continuing to be a yes today, and tomorrow, and the next day, and the next day, and the next day. And if this is your initial yes, may it become a long-term contract to be fulfilled with thanksgiving and love. For these are things that we do, these are things that help us get beyond the conditions we find ourselves in. These are the conditions that despite the hopelessness that we find ourselves in, there is hope. Because as Jesus is our North Star, that's the one that guides us. May it be so. Amen. Let's stand for our confession this morning. God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. Today, the good news is being announced. The Savior is calling. Let's take a moment to silently reflect on our own lives and make personal confession to our God. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. Our lives have been short-sighted and surrounded only with ourselves. We need repentance and the good news your Son, Jesus Christ, came to proclaim. For his sake, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and let your light shine upon us so that we may delight in your will and follow where you call, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Good news, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, in him, the kingdom of God has come near. As a called and ordained minister of the church of Jesus Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Have a seat.
Was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My mornings grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life began. Oh, your grace, oh.
washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. Released from my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. Canceled my debt and he called me his friend.
Oh, yes, he did.
When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made me. Your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with you.
Oh, yes, it does. Our life begins with you.
Our Savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost.
But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with you. Oh, we're free, free, forever we're free. Come join the song of all the redeemed. Yeah, forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, we're free, free, forever we're free. Come join the song of all the redeemed. Yeah, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began. When death was arrested and my
Please stand for our prayers this morning. Guided by Christ and the one who knows the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, for the world, and for all people who are in need. For your church throughout the world, O God, for pastors and teachers, for deacons and deaconesses, for musicians and servers, that all may proclaim the good news of God's reconciling love. We pray for your mercy. For those who provide leadership in our nation, its cities and around the world, we especially pray for our new president. We pray for nonprofit and non-government organizations. We pray for planning commissions and homeless advocates. that God may inspire all people to use their God-given talents, influence, and power for the betterment of humanity and to God's glory. Have mercy on us for that. We pray for those who are sick, those who are distressed or grieving. We pray for the outcasts and all who await relief, especially those we mentioned before you from our hearts at this time. That in the midst of suffering, God's peace and mercy may surround them. May you have mercy, O God. We pray for Hosanna and for Pataskala and beyond, for families big and small, for our preschool that meets here during the week, that God's steadfast love may serve as a model for all that we do. Have mercy on us, O God. We pray for Thanksgiving for our ancestors. Our ancestors in the faith who lived and served you and became examples to us of gospel living and that pointed us to salvation through Christ. Thank you for their lives. Merciful God, hear the prayers that we're offering to you, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your only Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread and he gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Then again, after supper, Jesus took the cup. And after he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Joining hands with only those in your household, Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. When you come forward for communion, you'll come to this one of these larger tables first. Keep your mask on, and you get your bread. If you like gluten-free, it's on the little tray next to it. Get your wine. If you want grape juice, that's in the center. Then you come over to the little table where now you could take your mask off. Have your bread and your wine. Put the empties in the basket, put your mask back on, and then you can return to your seat. Just remember, folks, don't come up to that first table until the people at the second table have moved on. Beloved people of God, the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ is given and shed for all of you. Amen. Thank you. Please stand. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. We are fish of your catching, O Christ, yet you call us to be fishers too. So transform us, your fish, into fisher folk. Make our catch nothing short of miraculous, for you are the Lord forevermore. Amen. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you now and forevermore. Amen. Have a seat. Enjoy our closing music.
Share the good news.